It's a great pleasure to be with you here today, Tel, as you think back at some of the highlights of your career in tropical medicine. Perhaps we could start with some of the highlights of the your early life as you as some of the bases for how you got into this business were formed.
Well, I guess I've always been kind of an ecologist because I grew up in the Santa Monica Mountains community of Pacific Palisades in California, and early on became acquainted with nature in Temescal Canyon and in other parts of what is now the Santa Monica Mountains National Park. One that I knew well was Beetle, the geneticist who really got one of the first Nobel Prizes in molecular biology. And I subsequently helped him out. He had a paper to present in Chicago. They didn't have airplane transportation in those days. So he asked me to make a motion picture of his Neurospora colonies. And he took it by train. When he came back, he gave me the film, not knowing what the historic import of this would be.
So you were already a cinematographer?
Yes. This grew out of still photography in high school. And my summer work for 3 years was in Yosemite National Park as a photographer. And then at the beginning of 1942, we undertook a study of the Golden Eagles in Calaveras County in Northern California. And I climbed about 60 feet up a sycamore tree to an eagle's nest and saw these newly hatched young and knew that a still picture wouldn't do them justice. So I borrowed a camera. We didn't have any money then, on the understanding that we would buy the film from the photo shop if they'd loan us the camera to use it. Then, of course, the Pearl Harbor came and the priorities and everything, so then we were forced to buy the camera, too, because there wouldn't be any more. And that led into really a career-long interest in photography, which has documented most of the things that we'll talk about today.
Also a career-long interest in ornithology, starting not just with golden eagles, but with turkey vultures.
This study of the nest life of the turkey vulture, which is a number one article in the 1942 issue of the Condor magazine, which scholars know is one of the most difficult journals to be published in. There it was, and it remains a classic to this day about nest life of the turkey vulture. And there are two vultures then in California, the turkey vulture and the California condor, so our sights were then set on doing the other vulture. I was sent to sea in an oil tanker, which was in support of MacArthur's occupation of Japan. And that was my real introduction to tropical diseases.
How would life on an oil tanker get anybody into tropical medicine?
Well, of course, I'd had some exposure to it in Treasure Island Naval Hospital, where we received various types of tropical diseases from people returning from the South Pacific. My first duty was in a skin disease ward. But a lot of people don't know that after the surrender of Japan, the MacArthur occupation became responsible for providing petroleum to Japan, and the people were on the verge of starvation. No fuel for their fishing boats. So the number one priority was to get fuel for the fishing boats. And most of the tankers afloat at that time, as was ours, a fleet tanker, were in the Navy. So they set up a lifeline from the Persian Gulf to Japan, and the average was 1 1/4 tankers of fuel each day delivered in Japan for a 2-year period. But along the way, we would stop in Singapore or Ceylon or One time we would go to Ras Tanura in Saudi Arabia, another time to Bahrain in the Persian Gulf, which has been very much in the headlines.
What were the circumstances surrounding your leaving the Navy?
My 2 years obligated service, which was really the beginning of the doctor draft, as it subsequently became known, gave me a termination date of, I still remember it, 28th of March of 1948. But by that time, I had developed a focus on a career in tropical medicine. And it's interesting the way this began because, you know, when you're a medical officer in a tanker without any acute cases to deal with, you've got a lot of time to read. And I'd read a lot of books relating to tropical medicine and American literature and so forth. And I learned about the Rockefeller Foundation. And we used to come into Portsmouth Naval Yard, and in uniform you could go over to the local Navy Air Base and get a free ride up to New York, which I did, knowing that I wouldn't get the medical guard again before we were scheduled to sail. So, looking for some way to entertain myself in New York, I decided to go see the Rockefeller Foundation, what it was all about. And I walked into the main office, and the secretary said, well, she knew what the insignia of the medical corps meant. She said, Dr. Work, what can I do for you? I said, I came to see what this Rockefeller Foundation is all about. And there, of course, was the logo for the benefit of mankind throughout the world. So she said, just a minute, and went down the hall, came back and said, Dr. Smith will see you in a few minutes. And instead of a 5 to 10 minute quickie, it was over 3 hours, and he grilled me in retrospect. He was really exploring whether I had an interest in taking Ken Smithburn's place of 10 years duration over in the yellow fever lab in Entebbe, Uganda. And at that time, I had no use for a laboratory of business at all. I was a field man and interested in conquering diseases of populations, not in the confines of a laboratory. It changed later on. But out of that grew an acquaintance. He was really my first mentor in tropical medicine because he had, being a bachelor, spent the war in London, even at the time when the Germans blew up part of the London School of Tropical Medicine, which has actually been built by the Rockefeller Foundation. And so I told him of my plans to go to the London School of Tropical Medicine. He said, well, the secretary to the dean's a very good friend of mine. Where are you going to stay? And of course, at that time, London, bombed out London, didn't have many places even for the local population. So he arranged for me to have digs with a local health officer, Miss Kathleen Shaw. Was the one who arranged it, and so I had a place to stay in London. And it was during this time in London that a mutual interest in ornithology with Sir Philip Manson Barr, then Emeritus Professor of Tropical Medicine from the school and son-in-law of the great Sir Patrick Manson, developed into an invitation to go with him to the Fiji Islands to work on filariasis. 40 years after his original monograph study was written on his honeymoon. So, subsequently, I went to the Fiji Islands and spent a year and a half there working on filariasis. And that's where I learned to think like a mosquito, although I was somewhat disappointed at not having daily care of patients with elephantiasis. One of my jobs was to go around. The Fiji Islands are about 250 in number, and 100 of them are inhabited. And it used to be my job to collect the cases of different stages of filariasis, elephantiasis, and bring them back to the hospital for our research. But I learned how to collect mosquitoes and identify them and dissect them and feed them on the patients to pick up the microfilaria and so forth. So it was a very good basic discipline. So at the end of my time in Fiji under the Fiji Colonial Medical Service, I wrote Hugh Smith a long letter recounting what had happened. And his response was, well, if you're ever in New York again, why, drop by and see me. And we'll talk about your experiences in Fiji. Well, at that stage of my life, I was a regular 2 to 6 week Audubon screen tour lecturer, going to different parts of the country, giving lectures on conservation with motion pictures that we'd made of our ornithological work in California.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing was a commitment to take back to London the records and the film on filariasis in the Fiji Islands.
There was a film done in the Fiji Islands?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
It's a documentary of all the aspects of filariasis as it was then known and still is in certain of the other islands, in spite of Heterozen coming along as a filaricide. But anyhow, when I got to New York, I went to see Hugh Smith, and he introduced me to the director of the International Health Division, or its descendant. Its name has changed many times over the years, but at that time it was still focused on international health. And the group there in New York, I showed the film to. Then I was invited to Dr. Andrew Warren's office afterwards for an interview. He was the director. And Hugh Smith brought up the subject about turkey vultures. And Dr. Andrew Warren leaned over and he said, what color are the nestling young? I said, white. They have two coats of down. They go through before the black feathers appear. He says, well, that's the way we saw them in North Carolina when I was a boy. And so then they suggested that I apply for a Rockefeller Foundation fellowship to Johns Hopkins for a Master Public Health degree, which I was also intending to do because I learned in Fiji that I didn't know enough about epidemiology and biostatistics to do hard-based epidemiological studies.